so cool. So yeah, I'm here to answer questions about my guitar playing, and most of all, just to play some music and have a good time. Gonna be signing some autographs later, so I'll play a couple songs for you guys, and we'll do a Q&A and have some fun. All right? Cool.
Yeah.
All right. This one's called "Shouting Fire in a Funeral."
Yeah.
We'll be right back.
You're so kind. Awesome. All right, keep on playing. This one's called J2 Unit. You guys doing today? Good?
Yeah.
He's got some questions for me about guitar, or about my old band, Nevermore. Or about me in general. Anybody. This guy. Yes?
At what point did you, like, think that you wanted to play 7 strings instead of 6 strings?
That was, like, right around 2000, when the record Dead Heart in the Dead World came out. And at that point in time, I was really into Meshuggah, Destroy Your Race and Prove. And me and Pat O'Brien were like listening to that a lot at that time.
Oh,
like,
oh, yeah!
They're gonna be in Australia next week.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I had a friend of mine. I love Cannibal Corpse, man. A friend of mine made a 7-string guitar for me from scratch, like, because it's like master luthier. And I just started playing them, and just really liked the tone and the overall, you know, chunkiness of it. So I just started using them and never stopped, you know. It's just a comfortable guitar for me to play, and I like it. It works for me. Everybody asks me if I'm going to play 8 strings next, but nah. Yes, sir. Nice shirt.
Oh, thanks. What practice methods did you use to improve your vibrato?
Listen to a lot of good singers. You know, if you listen to good singers that have, like, a naturally good vibrato in their voice, I tried to replicate that and really just, like, I don't know. Vibrato takes a lot of work. It takes years and years to really get down, you know, and you really have to just make that part of your style. Yeah. You know what I mean? Practice slowly on it and just kind of make it soulful, make it something that's yours, that original.
Yeah. Hey, Jeff, thanks for coming. Sure. Oh, yeah. Hey, this is a question regarding recording.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, maybe, like, the most recent album. When it comes to tracking guitars, say, for example, like a heavy rhythm or something, how do you go about that? Do you go, like, separate takes on, like, left and right or stacking guitars? Or
I quad-track everything.
Quad-track?
Just to make it, you know, a lot of people say that quad-tracking is kind of overdoing it, it kind of starts taking away from the actual goodness of the...
Is that just for, like, just maybe one particular riff, or...?
Me and Aaron, my producer for the new record, ended up doing it for the entire record, just because it was sounding so good and really solid. It laid down, like, a really good foundation, you know, for leads to be played over. So, initially, we were just going to do it for, like, a song, just to test out and see how it worked, and we did that, and it sounded good, so we just kept on going with it. But even back in the day, like when I was doing Nevermore stuff with Neil Kernan and Andy Sneap, we always quad-tracked everything just because it's like almost this wall of guitars, you know what I mean? And it just sounds so concrete.
I just wanted to know because just sonically, like apart from playing, which is already awesome, like sonically it was just that sound was just like really...
It's
just like so
too.
Thick and textured and stuff.
Everybody says less is more, but like Yngwie says, more is more. But it's cool. I've always done it. It's kind of tricky to do because once you start layering stuff up like that, you know, it gets more harder to replicate the previous.
Yeah.
So you really have to be accurate with your technique and your right hand and stuff like that. It takes a while to really get down.
Yeah.
But you can practice that at home just by recording yourself.
Yeah.
Do it like that and good luck to you, man.
Thanks, man.
I got a couple of questions. About the And the Maiden Spoke piece from the latest Nevermore album. How did you go about composing that? And the other question is, I noticed in, I think it's the Ultimatum from your latest album, sort of like some impressionist type, you know, like Debussy type tonalities to it. Is that sort of what you're going for, or was there another sort of influence from that? Or?
The Ultimatum was kind of really 80s influenced from, or early 90s influenced from like the Shrapnel Shred era players, like Tony McAlpine. Okay. And of course, he's on that song with me. You know, I was very fortunate to have him as a guest on that song. But that kind of came from that era and something that I kind of wanted to do just because I wanted to show people that that's what inspired me to play guitar. So that's where that came from.
Yeah.
The Maiden Spoke was just literally, I had my 8-track and a bunch of weird like sounds dialed in on a line 6 thing.
Yeah.
And I just started messing around with some clean stuff. And I had a drum machine, and I just did it from scratch, you know, just sitting at my kitchen table composing. That's how I do it. I keep it really simple. So.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, dude. Thanks. Anybody else? Yes.
Would it be possible to play any of the songs on a six-string guitar?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, a lot of people ask, you know, like, how do I play the earlier Nevermore stuff? You know, do I change guitars? But actually, a seven-string guitar is really a six-string guitar with an extra string, so I'm able to play all of that stuff as well. Okay. So, just really just one extra string, bro. Yeah.
What age did you start playing, and also, for the seven strings, is it an extra low string or a high string?
It's an extra low, extra low string. I started playing drums first, believe it or not. I knew I was interested in music because my father had a very big record collection full of 70s and 60s music, and I just started playing this stuff. And he saw that I was taking interest in it, so he bought me a drum set. I became quickly bored of the drums, and my dad had a guitar laying around the house, and I picked that up and started playing it, and I never put it down. So that's kind of how my career started with that. I was about probably your age. How old are you?
13.
That's exactly how old I was when I started guitar. Yeah. Cheers, man. Yeah.
What do you think of the Axe FX, and do you use that?
I do. I'm using it now, as a matter of fact. I'm using that with an Engel power amp, and it's awesome. I mean, if you take the time, you can really dial in tones that you want.
Yeah.
Everybody's using it, you know?
I've got the same
periphery style. Guys, and, you know, it's just really awesome because you can get the foot switch with it, and everything's right at your feet, man, you know? I have a rhythm sound dialed in, a clean sound, a lead boost. I have a third harmony thing in there, and also an octaver. And it's just, it sounds amazing. It really does. So I recently switched to that, and that's what I'm using. Get one. Oh, you got one.
Yeah.
Congrats.
When you were younger, did you have a set practice routine, or would you just go in, say, mess around, warm up, play this song, or play this bass?
Yeah, it's a good question. I never really set time, like how long I was supposed to play. I just enjoyed it so much that, you know, I'd start playing at like 9 in the morning, and then by the time I was done, my mom was knocking on my door for dinner, you know, so I realized like 9 hours just went by, and that's just how much I liked it. I think that, you know, there's a lot of guitar players that are young nowadays that want to become good really quickly, and they skip a lot of that routine stuff to become technically proficient, so I think it's very important that you put the time in, you know, to really focus on your picking and stuff like that, but you have to put the time in, man. It's very important to practice, and play with a metronome. That's what I did. Yes.
And do you have any like pre-show rituals, routines, warm-ups, any of that sort of thing before you go on stage?
A jump rope. No, man. Really just play my guitar, you know? Play my guitar for at least an hour. Now that I'm getting older, you know, it's like my fingers take a little bit more time to really warm up, so I have to play like a good hour to get the blood flowing, you know?
Any specific warm-ups?
Just like scalar stuff, just connecting, you know? Kind of like legato, like, oh, not legato, but like picking and muted, just to make sure I'm hitting every note, things like that. Or I'll just do chromatic stuff, you know? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Or just, I don't know, just a lot of picking stuff, really. Just make sure the vibrato sounded good. So it sounds good, and I know I'm hitting it. Yep. Play like AC/DC riffs. Yeah, anybody else?
Yes.
Yeah.
I just want to ask. I noticed in your instructional DVD a technique that you used that I've noticed would be like sounds really good when you get it right, which is a commie picking.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed you fucking nail this run.
Fucking nail it,
man. Like, are you fucking mortal, man?
It's
you just don't make mistakes, like.
Yeah, economy picking is just one of those things that kind of naturally came, you know? It's like,
is it useful? Like, is it
very much so, yeah, especially if you can't alternate that well. You know, but because it's almost like you're,
that's kind of like a natural problem that I have, because I'm right-handed, but I'm left-handed, so I don't have that natural.
That's kind of the reason I picked up on it, because I actually pick like three different ways. You know, everybody's always like, you always have to pick up and down. I do alternate picking, I do economy picking, and I do picking with legato. So it's like a combination of all those three. But really, the whole economy thing came because I couldn't alternate all the like three note sequences going down. You know what I mean? So I just started with playing that sequence with an upstroke, and it's almost like just...
And just all up like...
It's almost like a weightless thing with your hand coming back.
How long did it take you to kind of get that on your hands? Because at the moment it feels really fucking weird to me.
It's one of those things where it's almost easier for me to play a scale coming down than going up. So make sure you practice both ways, but it's in forever, man. Like, long time.
Yeah.
But once you get it, it's kind of like riding a bike. You never forget how to do it, you know? But,
Also, man, I was just wondering if you could just play this one scale pattern that I saw you play on that DVD. It's called, like, that, I don't know, flat B minus some bullshit.
Planes of Oblivion is completely reamped with an EVA, the new EVA head. That's the whole.
So you do your tracking at home and then like reamp in the studio?
We had a few different amps in the studio that we tried, but ultimately the EVH was the best sounding. Yeah. Hey man.
Hey.
I know you.
There is like almost no pick noise in your sound at all. What do you use?
I'm using Dunlop 2mm Sharpie picks. And I have a bunch of them here if anybody wants to check them out. I've got them in the back somewhere.
Just too perfect.
Classically speaking, who are you influenced by classically?
CPE Bach, Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach, Chopin. Paganini, of course. Really just Mozart, you know, stuff like that. My dad had so much of that stuff, so I spent hours listening to it. Love it all, really. Yeah.
I saw you in one of your videos, I think it was a Guitar World one, that you said you lowered your string gauge because you started getting some kind of tendonitis kind of problems.
Mm-hmm.
I've kind of got that at the moment. I'm just wondering what you kind of do to manage it and make sure you don't overdo it.
Really just don't overplay.
Just don't. Yeah.
I literally had to put the guitar down for like a couple of months just because, I always thought that using heavier strings was just being more brutal, you know, but really nobody knows the difference. Man.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
I can have like eights on here, you guys would know, but... I was using 10 through 52 and a 70 on the bottom, but I switched up and now I'm using 9 through 46 and a 66.
Oh, okay, cool.
And ultimately, I mean, when you lighten up on strings like that, it's when you're hitting the low chords where it tends to fluctuate sharp. But with these, it's still the same. You know, you can really still hit them. So it still sounds good.
Yeah, that's
what's most important to me.
Yeah.
So, if you're having problems with your hands, definitely lighten up on your strings.
All right, cool. How do you compose your solos? Do you kind of just go in and, like, for example, the Bourne solo is, like, fucking my favorite one. Did you just kind of just go in there and just shred, or did you kind of...
It was a lot of that. It was really, when I do solos, it's a combination of improv and a combination of having it worked out. I tend to think that when you're a guitar player and you work out everything, it sounds worked out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's not really... It doesn't have that flash and fire like you'd want, you know? So what I do is I kind of come up with a general concept of what I'm looking for, and then I'll go in, and then, you know, Andy Sneap, for instance, would just be like, let's go for it, you know?
Yeah.
And coming through the main so loud, you just, you know, your hair and your arm starts to get, like, you get excited. So that's kind of what I do, is I work a little bit of it out, and then I just kind of go for it, and it usually takes, you know, two or three times, but in the long run, it makes for a better solo, I think. That's what I do, so... Cool. I'm gonna play some more and then we'll do some more. You're welcome. Some more questions, all right? Cool.
Yeah.
This one's called Mercurial. We'll be right back. All right. Here's another one. This one's called The Ultimatum.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Questions? Yes, sir.
Who's your favorite guitarist to work with?
My favorite guitar player?
That I worked with.
That what?
That you worked with?
That I worked with.
Like Keith Mirror, Holler.
Keith's awesome, yeah.
Yeah.
Have you seen the new video we did?
Yeah.
That's cool, man. We just got together one day last week, as a matter of fact, and threw that together. And he's a lot, so much fun to play with, man, because we kind of meld together very well. Yeah. So we're probably going to be doing some more stuff in the future. But I would have to say probably Marty Friedman. I played on his record Future Addict about 4 years ago, and I got the opportunity to go into the studio with him, and he just like schooled me, man. I literally sat there for like 4 hours and just listened to him talk. He's like a guitar guru, you know. He just knows so much about music, and it makes me cry. It's amazing. So I feel so honored to have worked with him. He's awesome.
I got a few questions again. sorry, I'm a very curious guy.
That's okay.
Anyway, just curious, is it possible that we might see like a band or like more collaboration with Keith Merritt? How do you approach your harmony writing? And three, how do you come up with like the lush sort of like progressions?
That's
three,
man.
Yeah.
How do I approach what now?
The lush like chord progressions in like say continuum drift, something like that. They're like sort of pretty as opposed to like metal.
Really, I mean, a lot of it's trial and error for me.
Okay.
You know, I'm just really sitting down and just kind of playing stuff. And if it sounds good to my ear, I'll keep it. You know what I'm saying? So really, it's like throwing colors on a canvas, like being a painter or something like that.
Yeah.
If it looks good and, you know, feels good, then stick with it.
Yeah.
As far as a collaboration goes with Keith, I don't know, we're just kind of jamming right now.
Yep.
I'm really kind of focusing on just my solo career, you know. Being in Nevermore for 18 years was a better part of my life, and I don't take that for granted. You know, I had some great times in the band, but for me personally, I wanted to move on and do my own thing and pursue other things. But so right now, after this tour is over with doing these clinics, I have 2 days off and I go right to Europe to do a headlining tour with my band. And we'll see what happens from there. I'm kind of just taking baby steps right now to see where other things are going to happen. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to, like, get into another band immediately. And, you know, I'm just kind of taking it slow.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So thanks for that.
Thanks for your questions and interest, man. Sorry. Yeah.
And what's your favorite scale or set of scales that you use in your songs?
My favorite scales?
Yeah.
Anything that sounds really just dark, you know? I've always been a fan of, like, the minor sounding stuff, you know? And I don't know if that's just because of where I live, with it raining all the time in Seattle, but I just prefer that really dark sound, you know, just the minor, something that makes you feel something sad, you know?
Yeah, harmonics.
So, harmonics?
Yeah.
Like harmonic minor scales?
Yeah.
Sure, yeah. And I really like the flavors of, like, the, you know, Japanese sounding scales, too, which are awesome. Obviously, Jason and Marty influenced.
Yeah. As you were talking about Marty Friedman before, like, was it? I think I read that you were like 16 and you went to audition for Megadeth, and like, I think you're a fan of Cacophony with Jason Becker and Marty Friedman. Did you tell Marty about that gig or something? And then
I did.
A week later, he's in Megadeth.
Yeah, I mean, it's such a. The stories almost became like a. Something that,
so I read in like a Guitar World, and I think it was you, mm-hmm. John Petrucci, and Dave Mustaine or something.
Yeah, Dave doesn't remember that.
Yeah, he doesn't remember.
I mean, it was a long time ago. It was 1988. I auditioned for him.
Yeah.
I didn't get the gig, obviously. I was pretty young. I was 16, and he just said, dude, you know, you're way too inexperienced. And he said, one day you'll become a great guitar player. Stick with it. And,
you know,
lo and behold, in 2005, Nevermore toured with Megadeth, and it was awesome. Playing like arenas, and it was killer. It's just one of those things that happened, and I ended up going to see Cacophony play in Chicago, because they were my favorite guitar duo. You know,
Marty. You see the new Jason Becker film? I haven't seen it yet, but
I haven't, but it comes out in December on DVD, and I'm going to be the first one to buy it.
Yeah.
I ended up telling Marty about it. And all I remember is his eyes lighting up. Oh, really, man? Wow. And not but a week later, he had the gig.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I had everything to do with it, but I know I definitely warned him about it and said that.
So you were kind of responsible for, like, roughing the
pace. I think I am, damn it.
Yeah.
So there. It's hard to see over there because of light.
I was wondering, like, when you start a guitar and you wanted to be better, and you imagine yourself in a position of being better, and you thought you'd be satisfied when you were there, do you ever reach that point of satisfaction? Because you're obviously good.
It's a great question, dude. I think if you reach your plateau, it just kind of, it's boring after that, right?
Yeah.
You want to always keep getting better. And I just strive to do that by, you know, just learning new stuff, you know? A lot of people like spend like thousands of dollars on lessons and all that stuff. I mean, you can literally go to YouTube and get free guitar lessons.
Yeah.
Like lately, I'm really into like gypsy jazz guitar playing, like Django Reinhardt, you know, like the kind of... stuff, you know, the flat picking and chicken picking, like, I mean, all that stuff you can find on YouTube and just like take a day of lessons and on your own for free. So I always just try to work on something new each day, and then you can get to at least a higher plateau, but just keep it interesting. And that's what I do, so I hope that helps.
Yeah,
right on, man. Anybody else? Yes.
Hey, when are you bringing your band here?
Man, I hope soon, because it's really great being back here. It's awesome. And thanks for having you guys. Thank you. I'll play you some more songs. Sound good?
Yeah.
All right, this one is called... What is this one called? Sibline Origin. This is off the new record. We'll be right back. So hey, thank you so much, you guys, for coming out tonight. I'm gonna play you one last song that I think you'll recognize, and I'll answer any more questions and hang out with you guys after the show, somewhere right around here. So thanks again for coming, and thank you for having me. Cheers. All right, you guys, give me a couple minutes and I'll be back up. We'll answer some more questions in time. So thank you.